Hey guys, welcome to the crash course of UGC NET paper 2, commerce and management. And in this session I'll be dealing with strategic management, and I'll be covering this strategic management in 1 hour. I'll be taking less than 1 hour to cover this strategic management. So this is a very vast subject, so I will be running like anything. Just try to follow me, just try to understand me. If you need, just take the screenshot of the screen or the PPT. So good luck. Let's start the topic. So before that, let me introduce myself. I am Sarin Raju Tardil, currently working as an assistant professor. I have cracked this UGC NET examination 5 times. That's my experience in this field. Okay, before going to the topic, let me acknowledge the textbook I have used. These two textbooks were used by me. One is Strategic Management Concepts, A Competitive Advantage Approach, written by Freda David. It's one of the famous textbook in this area. Along with that, I have used this UGC NET JRF textbook prepared by Upkar. Okay, you can buy this textbook from Amazon. I will be putting the link in the description. Okay, so this is the syllabus I will be handling. Just take a screenshot and check regularly whether I am sticking onto the syllabus. Actually, this syllabus is given by NDA NET. Okay, so have a check whether I am covering all the topics or not. Let me start with a bookish definition of strategic management. Basically, strategic management is a continuous process that evaluates and controls the business and the industries in which an organization is involved. So it will be basically evaluate and controls the business and industries. Okay, along with that, it will be having a check on its competitors, and it will be helping us to set goals and strategies. Okay, along with that, it will be reevaluating our strategies so that it is in tune with the changing environment. So this is a bookish definition. Just have a read. Now, characteristics of strategy. Basically, strategy is systematic. Okay, strategy is unified, comprehensive, and integrated plan of action. So it is basically systematic. Second, it is multidisciplinary. It is multidisciplinary as a new strategy influences all the functional areas like marketing, finance, human resource, and operations. Third, strategy is multidimensional. It implies that the organization should possess the resources and competencies appropriate for implementation of strategy as well as strong performance culture. Okay, so it's multidimensional. Next one is, it is hierarchical. On the top come corporate strategies, then come business unit strategies, and finally functional strategies. Hence it is hierarchical. Next one, the strategy is dynamic. Strategy is to create a fit between the environment and the organization's actions. As a result, environment itself is subjected to fast change. The strategy too has to be dynamic to move in accordance with the environment. Hence strategy is dynamic. Next, process of strategy formulation. First one is strategic intent. It includes vision, mission, values, and objectives. Vision basically means what the objective wants to become. Mission means what business the firm is in. Next, values means a common set of beliefs guiding the behavior of organizational members. Okay, next one, objective, which means qualitative goals. So all these include strategic intent. Next one is situational analysis. Situational analysis will be basically external as well as internal. External, it can be opportunities and threats, and internal, it can be strength and weakness. Okay, along with that, we need to identify the competitive scenario also. For that, we need to consider industry also. Next one, setting long-term quantitative objectives or goal. The objective should be quantitative, understandable, challenging, etc. So we need to set a quantitative objective as well as goals. Next one is formulation of strategic alternatives. We need to have enough alternatives so that if our strategy fails, we can sustain. Now, what are things includes in strategic decisions? Okay, strategic decision basically means what is organization's business. It includes what is organization's business. It includes our target customers. It includes where are the customers and how do they buy, what is the value to the customers. Okay, along with that, it includes what business, products, services should be included or excluding from the portfolio of the offerings. Next one, geographic scope of the business. Along with that, we need to identify what differentiate our company from its competitors. Next one, we need to understand the important opportunities and the risk for our organization. In the end, we need to find a way so that our firm can grow prosperously. Next, levels of strategy. There are 3 levels of strategy. One is corporate level strategy, second is business level strategy, and third one is functional level strategy. Corporate level strategy involves high level strategies or decision that will help a company sustain in a competitive advantage and remain profitable in future also. Now, business level is basically medium level of strategy. Okay, it focuses on market positions to help the company gain a competitive advantage in its own industry. Okay, third one, functional level. Functional level is basically lowest level of strategy. They focus on activities within and between different functions aimed at improving the efficiency of overall business. So these are the levels of strategy. Now, barriers to strategy formulation. What are the barriers to strategy formulation? First one is lack of information. Lack of sufficient information for strategy formulation. Next one, too much data. We are having a lot of data but less information. Okay, as a result, we can't formulate strategies. Next one, confusion and dilution. It is true that we treat the COO as the person responsible for formulating strategy. But in actual, everyone need to be a part of the strategy formulation. So this create a confusion, and as a result, we will be diluting the strategy formulation process. Next, old mindset. Actually, business will be running in a cyclical mode. There are periods of stability interrupted by periods of radical and revolutionary changes. But as time moves, senior managers may be out of touch with the environment, either because of laziness or because of overconfidence. But this old mindset will be affecting our strategies. Next one, if a manager is having a prior bad experience, he will not be ready to go for a new strategy. So prior bad experience and firefighting will be affecting the strategy formulation. Next one, content with the current success. Just assume that our business is in a success stage. So we don't want to change the strategy. Again, this will be affecting our strategy formulation. Next one, others. Others include poor reward structure, fear of failure, self-interest, fear of unknown. So all those things comes under others. These are basically the barriers to strategy formulation. So till now, we have completed strategic management, concepts, process, decision, and types. Now we are moving to strategic analysis, which include external analysis. These are Pesley Porter's approach to industry analysis. So let's move to strategic analysis. So strategic analysis. Every business will be operating in a business environment. Strategic analysis basically deals with researching in this business environment. Okay, so basically we are researching in the business environment in which our business operates. This is known as strategic analysis. This strategy analysis can be internal strategy analysis as well as external strategy analysis. Okay, now I'm starting with external strategy analysis, PESLEI. PESLEI is basically the acronym for political, economic, social, technological, legal, and environmental. All these macro environmental factors we will be studying in PESLEI analysis. So basically, PESLEI analysis describes a framework of macro environmental factors. All these are macro environmental factors used in environmental scanning component of external strategic analysis. Now, PESLEI is added with ethics and other demographic factors. So now we are having an extended PESLEI which includes ethics and demographic factors. Now let's analyze each PESLEI elements. First one is political. Now here we will be checking whether our government is stable. Is there is any election in due? Who are the most likely contenders for power positions? All those things we will be studying in political. Second one is economic. In the economic, we will be checking whether our economy is stagnating, whether it is growing, or it is declining. So all those things we will be studying. Along with that, we will be studying our exchange rates also. Next one is social cultural. Alangil socio cultural. It is basically we will be checking whether our population is growing. What is the age profile? What are the current employment patterns? Is there any generational shift in attitude? All those things we will be studying in social. Next one is technological. We will be checking whether any new technology is there to come in new horizon or in near future. We will be checking whether any new technology is coming in the near future. Okay, along with that, we will be checking whether our competitor have access to new technology. This include technological. Next one is legal. We will be checking whether there is any reason change in our law. Okay, whether there is any reason international change to the law. Along with that, we will be studying any regulatory body is there which is affecting our business. So all those things we will be studying legal. Next one is environmental. Okay, so we will be checking whether the current environment is affecting our product, or is there any environmental issue with our products. Along with that, we will be checking our stakeholders or investors. All these are environments also. Is their values changing? So all those things we will be studying in this environmental factors. Now, second external strategic analysis is done by Porter's approach to industry analysis. It is used by, this analysis is made by 5 different factors. First one is buyers, second one is suppliers, third one substitute, fourth one new entrants, fifth one existing rivals. Now buyers are always happy to pay less and get more. Okay, so consumers simply want to get the cheapest item. So we need to consider this bargaining power of these buyers or customers. Now suppliers want to pay more and to deliver less. Again, powerful suppliers will insist on higher prices or more favorable terms. So again, we need to face this bargaining power of suppliers. Next is substitute, where a product or service can be easily substituted for something else. Okay, these may not be the rivals, they came from different industries also. They can come from different industries also. So we need to contend with this threat of substitutes. Again, new entrants often cause tension. Occasionally a new company arises that does something differently at a lower cost, but provide the same service, can affect our business. So this threat of new entrants is a usual affair in the industry. Next one is existing rivals. The existing companies or the competition still needs to be accounted, because an intense competition can reduce everyone's profitability. So we need to check for this threat from existing rivals also. So we have finished strategic management along with that strategic analysis also. Now we are moving to internal analysis, which include resource based approach and value chain analysis. Let's check those topics. Now internal analysis basically deals with understanding our business in detail. It would start with tangible resources and intangible resources. Later we need to move to human resources. Basically, this internal analysis examines your organization's internal environment in order to assess its resources, competencies, and competitive advantage. So this is very important as far as the business is concerned. The first topic in internal analysis is resource-based approach or view. It is basically a managerial framework used to determine the strategic resources a firm can exploit to achieve sustainable competitive advantage. Actually, we need to get a sustainable competitive advantages. For this, we need to exploit the strategic resources of the firm. For that, we need a managerial framework. This managerial framework is known as resource-based approach or resource-based view. So it is known as RBV. So the first feature is like firms are heterogeneous. Basically, firms have heterogeneous resources, which means firms can have different strategies because they have different resource mix. Till they are having different resource mix. As a result, they can have different strategies. Second is focus on managerial attention. Basically, managerial attention on firms' internal resources in an effort to identify those assets, capabilities, and competencies with the potential to deliver superior competitive advantage. We basically need a superior competitive advantages. For this, we will be checking our assets, our capabilities, and competencies. The third one is comparative advantages. Firms in possession of a resource or a mix of resources that are rare among competitors. And those competitors are having comparative advantages. These comparative advantages enable firms to produce marketing offerings that are either having a superior value or having lower cost. So we need to check for this comparative advantages also. Next one is external opportunities. At the same time, we need to check for external opportunities also. So these all four are the features of resource based view. Next, we will be studying value chain analysis. Okay, value chain analysis is a process of dividing various activities of business into primary and support activities. Primary activities means activities that are performed to satisfy external demand. And support activities are those which are performed to satisfy internal requirements. Okay. So value chain analysis is a process of dividing various activities of business into primary and secondary activities and analyze them, keeping in mind their contribution towards value creation. So importance is given for value creation. Now, classification of value chain analysis. I already told you that value chain analysis consists of primary activities and secondary activities, and primary activities are used for satisfy external demand and secondary activities are for satisfying internal requirements. Now let's check the primary activities and secondary activities. First primary activities is inbound logistics. It includes a range of activities like receiving, storing, distributing, which make available goods and services for operational process. Second one is operations. The activity of transforming input raw materials to final product, which is ready for sale. This includes operations. Next one is outbound logistics. As the name suggests, the activity that helps in collecting, storage, and delivering the product to the customer is outbound logistics. Next one is marketing and sales. All the activities like advertising, promotion, sales, marketing research, etc. perform to make the customer aware of the product. Okay, this is marketing and sales. Next one is service. Service means service provided to the customer so as to improve or maintain the value of the product. It includes financial services, after-sales services, etc. So, these are the primary activities. Now, let's check support activities. First one is procurement. Procurement is an activity serves the organization by supplying all the necessary input like material, machinery, and other consumable items. that required by the organization for performing primary activities. Second one is technology development. At present, technology development requires heavy investment, which takes years of research and development. However, its benefits can be enjoyed for several years. Next one is human resources management. It is the most common plus important activity which excel all primary activities of the organization. It encompasses overseeing the selection, retention, promotion, transfer, appraisal, and dismissal of staff. Next one is infrastructure. This is the management system which provides its services to the whole organization and includes planning, finance, management information systems, quality control, legal, government affairs, etc. So these are the support activities. Just have a glance of these primary activities and support activities. So we have completed internal analysis, which include resource based approach and value chain analysis. Now we are moving to strategy formulation. How a strategy is formed by using SWOT analysis. Let us move to strategy formulation, SWOT analysis. Okay, SWOT is an acronym for strength, weakness, opportunities, and threats. Okay, in this, threat and weakness are internal factors, and opportunities and threats are external factors. SWOT analysis is the most renowned tool for audit and analysis of overall strategic position of the business and environment. So we need to check the position of business and environment. For that, we are using a tool called SWOT analysis. Its key purpose is to identify the strategies that will create firm's specific business model that will align an organization's resources and capabilities to the requirement of environment. So our environment is having some requirements. For that, we are having organizational resources. We need to use this organizational resources to satisfy the environment. For that, we need specific business models, and for that we are using SWOT analysis. Now let's dig into deep of internal factors, strength and weakness. Strength are the qualities that enable us to accomplish the organization's missions. These are the basis on which continued success can be made, and continued sustained success, okay, can be made. Strength can be either tangible or intangible, but through this strength we can make continued success or sustained success. Next is weakness. Weakness are the qualities that prevent us from accomplishing our mission and achieving our full potential. These weakness deteriorate influences on the organizational success and growth. Now let's try to understand these external factors, opportunities and threats. Opportunities are basically presented by the environment within which our organization operates. These arise when an organization can take benefit of condition in its environment to plan and execute strategies that enable it to become more profitable. Understood? Now threats. Basically, threat arise when conditions in the external environment jeopardize the reliability and profitability of the organization's business. They compound the vulnerability when they relate to weakness. So these are the four factors which contribute to the internal factors and the external factors in SWOT analysis. So we have finished strategy formulation. Now we are moving to corporate strategy, which include growth, stability, retrenchment, integration, and diversification. So let's move into corporate strategy. Corporate strategy takes a portfolio approach to strategic decision making by looking across all of the firm's business to determine how to create most value. Okay, actually corporate strategy is using a portfolio approach to making a strategic decision. How it is making strategic decision? By looking across all firm's business to determine which is creating more value. Okay, this corporate strategy is built on the top of business strategy. So we'll be having a business strategy, on the top we'll be building corporate strategy. Now task of corporate strategy. Main task of corporate strategy includes allocation of resources, organizational design, portfolio management, and strategic trade-offs. First, corporate strategy is growth strategy. Growth means expansion and diversification of the operations of an enterprise. If the management is not satisfied with the present status, the environment is changing, favorable opportunities are available, in such cases, growth strategy will be helpful in expansion as well as diversification of the operations of the enterprise. This growth strategy can be implemented through product development, market development, diversification, vertical integration, or merger. We can use all these strategies to implement growth strategy. Now, these growth strategy can be growth through concentration, growth through integration, growth through diversification, growth through cooperation, and growth through internationalization. Now, let's start with growth through concentration. Basically, growth involves converging resources in one or more of enterprises' business. Let me make it more clear. This strategy involves investment or concentration of resources in a product line for an identified market with the help of a proven technology. So we are having a proven technology and we have identified a market and we will be concentrating the company resources in that area. This is known as growth through concentration. Second one is growth through integration. Under integration strategy, the firm continues serving the same customers but increases the scope of its business definition. So what it will be doing? Integration involves taking up more activities than taken up earlier. There can be backward integration as well as forward integration. So what here company will be taking up more activities. Now growth through diversification. Basically, diversification strategy involves a substantial change in business definition, singly or jointly, in terms of customer functions, customer groups, or alternative technologies of one or more of a firm's business. So what we'll be doing? We will be diversifying the business and as a result, we will be achieving growth. Now, growth through cooperation. There's a view that firms operate in a competitive market. When one firm gains in its market share, then one or more firms lose its share. It is a win-lose situation where if one wins, then one or several others have to lose. But many thinkers are thinking like they can cooperate and through which both can attain win-win situation and thereby growth can be attained. Next one, growth through internationalization. International strategies are a type of growth strategies that require firms to market their products or services beyond the national or domestic market. A firm would have to assess the international environment and evaluate its own capabilities and to form a strategy to enter into foreign market. So, by entering into foreign market, they can attain growth. So, these five are the growth strategies. Now, stability strategy. Just assume that our organization is satisfied in its present position. I'm getting enough profit. I can pay my shareholders. The company is going well. So, I don't want to change the present position. Okay. This strategy is known as stability strategy. That means we don't want to change from the present position. And as a result, we are following a strategy called stability strategy. First one is no change strategy. Okay. In no change strategy, actually we are doing taking a conscious decision to do nothing. We are not doing anything, okay, because we need to continue with the present work. Okay, it does not mean an absence of strategy. It doesn't mean that there is no strategy. There is a strategy to stick on the old strategy so that we can move with the old condition, or we don't need to change anything. This is known as no change strategy. Now, next one is profit strategy. Okay, just assume that the economy has taken a U-turn and the company or the industry is facing a dip. So in this time, what this profit strategy people will be doing, like, they won't be taking any decision or they won't be taking any new strategy. What they will be doing, like, they will be controlling expenses, they will be reducing investments, and they will be raising prices, they will cut cost. So they literally, they will try to increase the profitability. That's all. They won't be doing anything new, okay, or they won't be adopting any new strategies. So what they believe, like, the economy will be getting in the old route or in a well-off route in a near future. So it's always better to hold on the old strategy. The economy will be tuned in near future. Understood? This strategy is known as profit strategy. Next one is retrenchment strategy. An enterprise would like to retreat or retrench from its present position in order to survive or improve its performance. Actually, the economy is having some issue, like recession, tough competition, scarcity of resources. So a lot of issues are there. So what organization will be like doing, like, they will be retreating or retrench from present position in order to survive this recession period or tough competition. Okay, this strategy, though reflecting failure of the company to some degree, become highly necessary for the survival of the company. They are retrenching, so it is showing the failure of the company. Still, for the survival of the company, it's very important. This is, now next topic is turnaround strategies. Actually, this retrenchment strategy we were doing internally. Now I am going to explain you external retrenchment strategies. Okay, just assume that company is facing some issue. So they can use this turnaround strategy. Turnaround strategy basically means, just simple, let me explain it simply. I'm having a manager, and my company is having a manager. So the economy is facing some issues and I can't do anything. So what I will be doing, like, I can do two work. One is, my manager can outsource the process. I can approach some consultancies and ask for help, and they will be helping and will be allowing me to take a turnaround. Okay. Or the second one is, like, this manager is taking leave from the processes, and in that place, some other expert group or some other external consultancies will be taking over, and they will be helping us to take a turnaround. And this is known as turnaround strategy. Now, next one is disinvestment strategy. As the word suggests, it involves the sale or liquidation of a portion of business or major division or profit center. So we will be selling a few part. Since we are facing issues, we are selling a few part. This is basically disinvestment strategy. Now, liquidation strategy means closing down of a firm and selling its assets. That's what liquidation strategy means. These are the stability strategies. So just have a glance. Hope that you understand this. So next corporate strategy is integration. In that, I'm starting with vertical integration. Okay, just assume that a manufacturing is happening here at A, and that is my company. Okay, and A is getting raw materials from C, and A is giving the finished product to Z. Okay, if the company is taking any of these companies, okay, any of the company like C or Z, then it is known as vertical integration. If the company is taking C, then it is known as backward vertical integration, where we acquire a company which supplies us raw materials or components. Okay, now we are acquiring Z. Okay, then it is known as forward integration. So forward integration occurs when company acquires sales segments also. It also help the firm to control our sales and price. So if I am taking over Z, then it is mean that I am taking over the control over sales and the price, because I am taking the sales segment also. Next, full integration occurs when the firm seeks to control all stages of value chain. So if company is planning to take both C and Z, then it is known as full integration. Now partial integration means we are doing this selectively. Okay, only part will be taken. That is known as partial integration. Now next corporate strategy is diversification. In diversification, we will be entering into fields where both products and markets are significantly different from our firm's initial base. We are having our initial base and we are diversifying ourselves. That means we are entering into other segments, other product segments or other markets. Okay, this is known as diversification. Now diversification are of different types. First one is related diversification. It occurs when a firm expands into industries similar to its initial business in terms of at least one major function. So somewhat relation is there, but it is diversifying. How it is diversifying? It is the firm is expanding into industry similar to initial business only. Okay, this is known as related diversification. Next one is concentric diversification. Concentric diversification occurs when a firm adds related products or market. The goal of such diversification is to attain strategic fit. Okay. Strategic fit allows an organization to achieve synergy. Next one is conglomerate diversification. Conglomerate diversification occurs when a firm diversifies into areas that are unrelated to its current line of business. So we are having a line of business and we are diversifying from there. Then it is known as conglomerate diversification. Okay, here we are believing in synergy. Next one is internal diversification. Basically, internal diversification means we are finding new users for our current product. For example, I am increasing my geographic base. Just assume that I am operating only in USA. Now I need to enter into India. Then it is a type of internal diversification. I am finding more and more new customers. Next one is external diversification. External diversification occurs when a firm looks outside of its current operation and buys access to new products or market. Now we are looking outside of the current operations and we are buying new products or market. Mergers are one common form of external diversification. We can attain external diversification through mergers. Okay, now horizontal diversification. Horizontal diversification occurs when a firm enters a new business. It can be either related or unrelated. We are entering into a new business at the same stage of production as its current operations. Okay, so we are finished with corporate strategy, growth, stability, retrenchment, integration, diversification. We are finished with all those stuff. Now we are moving to business portfolio analysis. It includes BCG, GE, etc. All those metrics are there. So let's move into business portfolio analysis. So let's start business portfolio analysis with the most renowned or most famous BCG metrics. BCG metrics is a framework created by Boston Consulting Group, BCG. BCG stands for Boston Consulting Group, to evaluate the strategic position of the business brand portfolio and its potential. So in order to check the strategic position of business brand portfolio and its potential, this BCG, Business Consulting Group, developed BCG metrics. It classifies business portfolio into four categories based on industry attractiveness and competitive position. So basically there are four categories which depends upon relative market share and market growth rate. Okay, let's take each segments. I'm starting with dog. This is basically dog. Okay, dog holds low market share. It is holding low market share compared to competitors and operate in a slowly growing market, and our market growth is also low. In general, they are not worth investing in because they generate lower negative cash returns. Basically, from dog we will not be getting any cash returns. Okay, so our market share is also very less, along with our growth rate is also very less. Now let's move into cash cow. Cash cows are the most profitable brands and should be milked to provide as much as cash as possible. Here, just look, our growth rate is low, but cash generation or market share is very high. So we need to milk this cow so that we will be getting more and more cash. Okay, now let's move into this star. Stars operate in a high growth industries and maintain high market share. They're having high growth rate as well as high market share. Stars are both cash generators and cash users. It uses cash as well as it will be generating cash. They are primary units in which company should invest its money. Company need to put all the money. Company need to put or invest more and more money. Now move to question mark. This part. Question mark. Question marks are the brand that require much closer consideration. It need much closer consideration. They hold low market share. Their market share is very low. And they are in fast growing area. So what we need to do, we need to have closer consideration. We need to consider this question mark region. So this is basically BCG metrics. Now GE McKinsey metrics, the next metrics. Actually, this is a 9-box matrix. It's having 9 boxes which compare the business strength and market attractiveness. Okay, it will be using market attractiveness and business strength as the parameters. It's a systematic tool for the multi-business corporations to prioritize the investment among the business units. So they are having different business units and they need to prioritize their investments. You need to remember these things. BCG metrics is using market growth and market share, whereas GE is using industry attractiveness or market attractiveness and business unit strength or business strength. So you need to take care of these four terms: BCG, market growth and market share, and GE is using attractiveness and business unit strength. Next one is ANSOS product market growth metrics. So like BCG metrics, it is also having 4 grids. Okay, it's also having 4 grids and it is used by firms to analyze and plan their strategies for growth. So basically the company need to grow. For that we need to analyze and plan, and for this we will be using ANSOS product market growth metrics. Okay, the metrics shows 4 strategies that can be used to help the firm grow. We need to make the firm grow. For that we can use 4 strategies. What is market penetration? Next one is product development. Third one is market development. Third one is diversification. Let's take one by one. Before that, just remember that this is developed by Igor Ansoff. Okay, let's start with market penetration. Market penetration strategy can be done by different ways. So basically in market penetration, what we'll be doing, we'll be penetrating to the market using existing products. So how we can do this? We'll be doing by decreasing prices or by increasing promotional activities, or we can find new customers. Okay, likewise we can penetrate into market. Clear? Now next one is product development. In product development strategy, the firm develop a new product to cater to the existing market. So we are having a market, So what we'll be doing, we'll be finding one more product, or we'll be adding a number of products. As a result, our product development happens, and in result, market growth will be occurring. Next one is market development. In market development strategy, the firm enters a new market with their existing product. So we are having operations in USA. Now I am going to Canada. So what I am doing, firm is entering into a new market with their existing product. Then it is known as market development. Next one is diversification. Like I have already told you, diversification can be related diversification or unrelated diversification. We are diversifying our wings, or we are diversifying our branch. Okay, if you're diversifying to a related market, then it is known as related diversification, and if it is an unrelated market, then it is known as unrelated diversification. So we have finished this market portfolio analysis, all these models we have studied. Now we are moving to strategy implementation. In this, we'll be dealing with challenges of change and McKinsey's 7S framework. Okay, so let's move. Now we need to implement a strategy. For that, what are the challenges? Just have a glance on these terms. Those words are self-explanatory, so better have a glance. It's enough. Let me read the words: insufficient partner buy-in, insufficient leadership attention, ineffective leadership, weak strategy, resistance to change, lack of proper planning, low employee morale, lack of consensus, adopting new technology, and failing to communicate. So these are the challenges in strategy implementation. So all these words are self-explanatory. Just have a glance. That's enough for your exam purpose. So next topic is developing programs using McKinsey's 7S framework. It is basically a strategic planning tool which will be helping the organization to check whether the strategy which we are following will allow us to achieve our objective. So we are having some objectives. Now we need to achieve these objectives. For that, we have following a strategy. Whether these strategies will be helping us to achieve these objectives. For checking that, we need McKinsey's 7S framework. Okay, it is basically developed by McKinsey and company. But you need to remember this name also, Robert Waterman and Tom Peters in particular. Okay, it's an organizational analysis tool to assess and monitor changes in internal situation of an organization. So organization is having an internal situation. In order to analyze that, we need this McKinsey's 7S framework. Basically, there are 7 S and we need to know each S. Let's start with strategy. The organization plan to win in the marketplace. Okay, organization need to somehow win the marketplace. So how will it gain an advantage over its competitor? For that, we need strategies. So first S is this strategy. Next one is structure. The process or the organization structure, its people, its machinery, its money, etc. All these things need to be aligned in a proper way. So basically, structure means people, machinery, money, etc. All those things need to be aligned in teams and groups so that we can achieve organizational objective. Next one is systems. The process and daily activities that are undertaken by the people who work in the organization and tool they use. Basically, systems means the people, their process, and the tools they are using. All these comprises of systems. Next one is style. This is the way the organization does things. The organization is having one style to do things. This comes under style. Next one is staff. The employees of the organization, they include staffs. Next one is skills. the skills of the employees and the skills of the organizations. All these composed of skills. So what you need to remember is like, you need to remember the hardest. Hardest include strategy, structure and systems, and softest include skill, staff and style. So this is all about the subject. So for time being, I'm winding up. This was a crash course, so I was running like anything, and I tried to finish the topic in an hour. Hope that you understand the concept. So if you have any doubt, comment me in the comment session. I'll be trying to clear that. For time being, I'm signing off. Thank you.